So I just listened to the talk of previous three speakers, and they talked something I'm going to talk about as well. So information security, connection of our world, and so on and so forth. When I went to school at Johns Hopkins many years back, and I usually drove to Lancaster in Pennsylvania to purchase my clothes because they have no tax there, no tax for clothes there. And there's a small city called Amish. I don't know how many of you have ever heard this city, or small village, Amish. Anybody heard this city? No? Okay. The people live there still don't use electricity today. Can you imagine? They don't use electricity. Why? Because they thought it's not secure. And it changed their matter of life. They don't want to change. And today, if you look at our society here, almost everybody is connected to, let me see. Okay, here's, it's connected to the internet. If you want to say, well, I don't want to connect to internet, I want to get disconnected because I feel secure, you can do that. But it's not very convenient to leave. So people there in Amish, when we traveled to the town, I saw them, they still use their carriage to ride horses. Sounds a little weird to us, but it's the scenario there. You can still live in that style, but it's not really convenient. So what will happen in the future? In the future, the connection will be so dense that looks like this. Look like this picture, like this picture. So the connection is everywhere. So it's not just you draw a couple lines on the picture, and it looks like this. It's like a cloud or a fork or whatever you can call it. Because connection is so dense, you cannot solve many problems by our brain, and not even by the help of computer. We need a super artificial intelligence help us to solve the problem. So AI is important. It is the brain of the future city or the future society. Or you can think the entire country or the entire world is a super smart computer. So AI is its brain. IoT is like our eyes, hands, ears, or noses. They are sensors, so they connect information. We need something to connect information. And the blockchain is like a nerve system, and it's really important. Because today, not all the problem of information security is, your information you send out got intercepted by somebody in the middle, and you really need a very secure transmission. And the blockchain provide a mean to transmit information securely. And so I called, in the future we have a world of super AI, which is AI plus IoT plus blockchain. What's the benefit of high dense connection or network? Well, there are we can have many benefits from that. Number one is it's so easy for us to track the process of almost everything. Why is that important? Give you a concrete example. So an example in China, actually a very high rank officer of Alibaba told me the story. So if you shop for some prescription drug on the actually small drug store on the street, you have a chance, 20% of chance, that what you purchased is either out of date or just some counterfeit drug. And very high percentage, 20% is a very high risk. Why nobody wants to solve the problem? Actually, everybody try to solve the problem, but they can't because there's no way to track the source or provider. And even though you purchase something from the maybe the dealer or like Pfizer or Merck directly during the shipment in logistics, somebody changed one or two bottle, replaced one or two bottle in the boxes. So you still have a chance to get some faked one, which is very sad. And there's so far, the infrastructure technology cannot solve this problem. And also, if you want to see in McDonald's, for example, any fast food restaurant, whether the beef I had is very secure, okay, and it's from a secure process and from our farm with feed the stock in a right way. You don't know, have the information and you cannot find the information. There's no way to track. But in the future, there are some way to track it. And the blockchain is a good solution. Transaction security is very important because almost every year, some percent, about 0.1% of money got stored by some kind of transaction. Not very secure. You thought it's secure, but even though we have firework here, and but still after a while, somebody just get in to your account for many reasons. One reason is that your password is not secure. When I was in Google, and we found that, I don't know whether you know, in the past, what's the number one password people pick up? Just password itself. And the second, and there are some other password like ASDFG, it's one, and these kinds of password counts about 5% of the password people pick up. And you can get into their account maybe by 5 or 10 trials. So in the future, we thought there should be some way that all information are encrypted. And also, only you can access the information. And other people can only verify the truth of information. They cannot access. They don't need to. They don't need to. So this is what will happen in the future. And also, we need to track the health of ourselves. I don't know how many of you ever drive Tesla. There are lots of sensors in the car track the performance of the vehicle from time to time. I don't know how much information, how much data it connects every day. But whenever Tesla has a problem, you call the dealer and they can figure out the problem immediately. But for other cars, so for example, when my Porsche has a problem, I drop it to the dealer shop, and it usually takes them about 2 days. To figure out the problem and fix the car. So that's the difference. In Tesla, you go there, in 1 hour, they fix the problem and give you the car. So that's the benefit of track. We track the performance of vehicle, we track performance of jet engine. There are about 1,000 sensors inside a jet engine today. But there's no sensor inside our body. We don't know what happened inside our body whenever we have disease. There's no way, so far there's no way to track metabolism our body. So in the future, we need to track everything. But there's a problem. If we track the behavior ourselves, we track our activity, where should we store our data? Can we store our data in Google? Yes, we can. Can we store it in Facebook? Yes. But if you are very unlucky to be one of those 50 million people, you lose your data. Your data was sold in Facebook, by Facebook to somebody. And they not only earn money from your data, but you got this price discrimination. You face this problem. When you go to some airline company, their website, you probably pay 5 to 10% more if you purchase the ticket. If they know, you have to attend some event, maybe in 1 or 2 days. And if you call them, and even when you call them, usually they don't have your data. And you got about 5 to 10% off. And so that's why sometimes I go to the website and find the time and find the price, and I call them. I got about 5 to 10% less, actually. So why? Because they track your behavior, and you track lots of activities that will happen to you. So blockchain is our solution. And I want to skip this slide because I guess everybody here knows what is blockchain. Basically, it has two things. One is a record. When the record is generated when the real goods or the transaction happened. And then you cannot change that record. And then there's a chain to record all the process, that record, all that data, all that goods is on its way. What's the beauty of blockchain? It's asymmetric. So when you own the data, or you own that block, you are the only guy who can read the data. And nobody else can do that. They can verify whether it's true or not. So for example, today, if you want to Stanford University Hospital to do some statistics about the symptom and a disease, whether they have some correlation, you have to give the medical record to them, to the scientist. And they do some statistics, do some study. And then you lose the control of the data. So if you store the data to Facebook, Facebook can access data, even though in theory, by law, the data is your data. It's not Facebook's data. But you can't read data yourself. They can give you access. You don't know even the format of the data. And Facebook can benefit from using your data. So that's the scenario today. And in the future, you are the owner. You'll be the owner of the data. And Stanford Hospital will ask you a question, question to your data, say, whether this guy ever experienced some disease? You answer yes. And then they ask another question, whether during that time the guy has this symptom? And you can answer yes. The data will tell them yes or no. And they can repeatedly ask the same question to other people. They got whatever they want. They got their statistics. They got they found a correlation between the symptom and the disease. But they don't know who you are. And they have no access to all other domains of your data. So it's pretty secure. And also, you can earn money from that. Say, well, for those who want to do research, and or they want to improve your business from tracking the behavior of people, you pay me $0.05 to assess my medical, well, maybe $5 to assess my medical record, okay. And maybe after every year, I can get maybe $20 from that. And if you want to know my shopping behavior, that's fine. Everybody can access my data with my permit for 1 cent every time. So 1 cent is not that much, but you know maybe Amazon, Google, and Facebook, they use the data maybe 100 times every year. So you earn probably $100 as well. So if you have a very weird disease, for example, very hard to secure, too hard to cure, and many doctors will be very interested in that disease. And you can maybe make a mark $100 for a doctor who assess your medical record. And as long as many doctors assess your record and try to study your case, you have a bigger chance to get cured. So that's the benefit in the future. And then there has to be some way to store your data somewhere. physically, you can still store your data in Google, in Amazon, in Facebook, anywhere, any data center. But logically, it's your data. They cannot, they physically they have data, but they cannot access data without the public key. You can issue a public key to them. They can access data, ask the question for a period of time. Okay, so then you take your ownership back. So that's the beauty of blockchain, actually. And today, whenever people are talking about blockchain, usually they think about just coins. They issue some coins to earn money, but in the future, there are many, many applications can be built based on blockchain. So what's the potential usage of blockchain? Encrypting money is one thing. So everybody knows that. Fundraising is another. And yesterday, one of my friends told me, a professor from Berkeley, raised about $300 million by ICO. So she issued some coins for some internet security project. Instead of ask for NSF or DARPA for the fund, she had a new way to raise fund for her research. And why people give her money? Because they expect when the research is done, and they can benefit from that. Smart contract is another. So today, if you want to borrow, for example, borrow a mortgage from some banks, when you try to buy a property in maybe Palato, you have to send them the contract, say, well, this is my contract, and they know all the details, and they know lots of details. You don't want them to know details. They just want them to verify this transaction is true. That's it. Okay, and you also want to tell them the value of the property. You don't want them to know details. That's fine, and you can use the smart contract. Just send it to Citibank, and they can just verify whatever required for the loan, and they just give you the loan. And so that's the smart contract. Property registration, to register your vehicle, you register your house is fine. And the gambling definitely is a big market for blockchain. There are some other applications as well. And today, who purchased Bitcoin? Who supported blockchain, actually? Very weird to you is that number one group is Chinese ants. Anties, so they are very, whatever has value, they just purchase. They even don't understand what is blockchain, what is Bitcoin, they just purchase. So this one group. Underground banks, it's actually quite, it's bigger than you thought. Between China and the US, and there's almost no way for Chinese investors to move the money outside the border, but there are underground banks. That's why the Bitcoin price is still very sustainable so far, couple thousand dollars. And also, there are some believers. They believe, like for example, the founder of Square, they believe in the future, digital currency is the only currency in the world. So that they have this belief. So whenever the Bitcoin price drops, they just jumped in and purchased the Bitcoins or any Ethereum coins. There's another usage of Bitcoin or whatever encrypted currency is to track the contribution everybody to the project and to some product. So in the past, we can track the contribution of our employee in your company, and you can give them some stock options. Say you make a contribution, I give you stock option, and they benefit from that. However, there's no way to appreciate the contribution, for example, of the first 10,000 drivers of Uber or the first 100,000 riders of Uber. They made a big contribution to that company, but their contribution cannot be rewarded because there's no way to track their contribution. So in the future, there's one way to do that is instead of pay them the money to ride Uber, you can pay some encrypted currency, and that's our way to track their contribution. And that can boost the business from the very beginning. So this is another way. Data sharing is one, data sharing, trading, and this is under the condition you take your data back instead of store your data in Google, because otherwise there's no way to track the track and trade and exchange your data. And today is the first generation of blockchain is Bitcoin. This is the first generation. The second generation is Ethereum. So we have already experienced the second generation. What's the advantage of Ethereum protocol versus blockchain? You can think it's just like Facebook versus Friendster. So Friendster is a very big social network, very successful one, but you cannot build your own society or your own application based on Friendster. Facebook is different. It's not more like a platform that you can build your own small society, you can build your own application, and let everybody else use your application. So today, Ethereum is like that. It's a platform. Based on that, you can issue your own ICO, and you can build your own application. So that's the beauty of the second generation. But still, there are some problems we have to solve. Latency is a big problem. If you want to go to Starbucks and buy a cup of coffee, it takes probably from 1 hour to 2 days to verify, if you use Bitcoin, for example, to verify whether you are the owner of that Bitcoin, or whether it's true or not, takes a pretty long time. And even though in theory the cost should be very low, but in practice, so far the cost is so expensive. If you just measure the electricity used to mine Bitcoin every year, divided by the number of transactions of Bitcoin, so if you can get a conclusion that if you want to purchase a cup of Starbucks, okay, the transaction cost, the electricity cost, is about $20. The Starbucks coffee itself is about $2 maybe, but the transaction cost is $20. So there are still lots of problems to be fixed, but all problems will become, all those uncertainties, problems, risk, eventually will turn out to be opportunities. So if you solve these problems, you are your leading position in blockchain in the future. So today, many scientists, especially mathematicians, they jumped into the society and tried to build the third generation of blockchain. So and I can see lots of applications will based on blockchain in the future. And it's just like Facebook, I would say, is in the stage of maybe 2006, 2007 of Facebook at that time, about 10, 11, 12 years back. So after 10, maybe 10 years, you look at blockchain, it's probably as mature as Facebook today. So there's lots of opportunities. Thanks.